Okay, we're tracking Splinter again. It's been about 2.5 weeks since we last located him. Now let's go see if we can find him. He may be in the big oak tree again. Let's go find out. Okay, so you guys haven't done this before, have you? And I'm gonna let you guys actually do the tracking, okay? It's really close by, but you wanna go towards the loudest beep. And notice there's a little bar graph right down here. See the little bar graph?
Yeah.
The more squares in the bar graph,
The closer he is.
That's the direction you want to walk. So spin all the way around and see if you can determine the loudest beep in quadrants. Anyway. Faint.
It's all the same all around.
That means, let me see, we need to adjust the gain. Okay. This actually makes it, reduces the signal a little bit and makes it a little less sensitive so you can pinpoint it. So watch. Why don't you try it? Okay, you step behind him.
So do I walk forward?
Yeah, walk forward and then do it. Spin around like we were doing. Give him a little bit of space. Okay, stop right there and spin all the way around one quadrant at a time.
It's all the same.
Exactly, the opposite of that.
It's all the same. I think we just got to go forward.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what. Let me
choose that.
Well, see if you can find it. He doesn't know where the tree is, so it's perfect. Let's see if he can find it. Pretty loud that way, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like all the way to zero.
Adjust this gain down just a little. Yep, he did.
His strongest pointing forward.
Maybe the bear ate him.
Maybe the bear.
Yeah, it goes to the...
Pretty loud, isn't it?
Strong signal, yeah.
Okay, now spin all the way around.
You like break your face.
Okay, I'll go that way. There's a little trail over there. And right here, and watch your step.
Yeah, it's that way. We got almost no signal that way.
Okay. Yeah. There you go, walk a little closer. Now watch where you step. He could be laying on the far floor. And if it suddenly gets really loud, stop. That's his tree, this big oak here, with that big horizontal limb. And if I was him right now, I would be laying in that sunspot, but I don't see him. Of course, he could be just over the top and we wouldn't see him.
No signal this way.
Let me see. I'm gonna take over since we're so close.
Thank you.
No worries. Did good job.
Thank you.
All right. Let's walk up to the tree. Just watch your footing. Let's see. Yeah, I think he's up there. And I think he enters through this hole. I mean, that's a possibility. I haven't looked up in there to see if it's open, but he either enters through the hole or he just climbs right up the outside of the tree, because if you look at the tree, see all those knobs and knots? Those are just steps for a rat snake. He'll climb right up this tree like it's nothing. Okay.
Is he inside the tree?
He could. I think he is, because if you noticed up at the top of the tree, it's hard to see from here, but there's a big hole open to the sky, and I think that's his access hole, that he crawls up the inside of the tree and crawls out of that hole. And then at night, he may actually bed down in that hole. There probably is a little flat area he can curl up and just sleep on. Pretty cool, huh?
That's a pretty chill spot.
It is. And think about this. This tree also, what else does it provide that snake? Besides protection, so shelter.
Shade,
if he needs shade, if he gets too hot. What about the food? Obviously food, because this tree is going to be an apartment complex to wildlife. Chipmunks, squirrels, birds, bats are all going to be using this tree as a roost.
Can he catch a squirrel?
Oh, yeah, and he will. Nice. Catch it, kill it, and eat it.
Does he have teeth?
He does. He has little recurved teeth, several dozen, and they help hold his prey. They're not fangs. They just help hold his prey while he swallows it.
So he could, swallow our fist?
Possibly, but that probably wouldn't be a good idea.
Which then, that means he swallows the animal wide.
Yeah, that was just re-
no, he kills it. He's a constrictor. He's a constrictor, so he wraps around it, squeezes it, and then when it dies, he then eats it.
Okay.
Now, if y'all look up there, there's one other thing this tree provides. You see that big horizontal limb?
Yeah.
What does that give him?
Sunshine.
Yeah, a place to bask in the sun. So this tree provides everything he needs, but you might be thinking, but where's the water? Okay.
Inside of the animals?
Inside of the animals, exactly. That's one of the places. And also, when it rains, these trees often have little pockets that form in some of the knot holes, and water collects in there, and he can go drink that water. You've got everything he needs. That's why these kind of these trees, these den trees, are extremely important. If you have a den tree like this on your land and it's not threatening to fall on a house, leave it alone, because it provides so much for wildlife, so much habitat, food, water, shelter, everything they need. Cool, let's get some data collected. Good job, guys. Okay, so I'm tracking Splinter again, and we're looking for him in a new area. He has left his big hollow tree and moved somewhere back towards the northwest. I had to think a minute. Sun's over there. So let's go find him. See here, another big oak with a horizontal limb. It's possible he's up in this tree, but we need to go past it and find out. Oh, wait a minute. I think he is. Check it out. This is exactly like that other tree he was in. It has a hole at the bottom. In other words, a front door. It's hollow on the inside. And it has, of course, like I just said, a big horizontal limb. Wow, I bet he's in there. I'm kind of at a loss now. Let's check this tree over here. I think he's in this tree. I was wrong. This tree is, what, 30 feet away from that one, and it's an even better den tree.
And it's got a hole in it.
Yeah, take a look at the hole. Now, notice it's not a really loud signal here, but when I point up, it gets a lot louder. So he's possibly in this tree. Come around here and look, make sure he's not. Yeah, take a look up in this tree, girls. See, there's a big hole where he could crawl out, and a horizontal limb, two horizontal limbs. He really likes these kind of trees. I think we found him. Obviously, we can't see him. I know that's kind of a disappointment, you know, you can't see him when we find him, but it just goes to show you that, you know, when you're doing this kind of work, you don't always get to see your study animal. You can just, you get to experience his habitat and learn about him through where he lives. I mean, just think about what this says about this rat snake, that we keep finding him in big hollow trees. Does that say something important about the tree and the snake? What do you think?
So he can crawl up it and onto the limb, and then, like you've said before, like bask in the sun. Like, it would be easier to lay down on a horizontal limb.
Mm-hmm.
Also, could be good for crawling up a tree and looking for birds' nests.
Birds' nests? What else might live in that tree?
Squirrels.
Squirrels? Who said that? Mice?
Yeah.
You'd be right. Mice would live in this tree?
Just kidding. Not mice. Squirrels.
Yeah, well, squirrels, mice, they're both rodents, right? Squirrels, mice, birds, bats, okay, chipmunks, all would live in this tree. And that little hole at the ground level gives that snake a great opportunity to be able to just crawl right in, crawl up the inside of the tree, and as he's crawling up the inside of the tree, he's finding food. And then he can crawl out that big hole at the top, crawl onto a limb, and bask in the sun and digest his meal that he just ate as he crawled up through the apartment tree.
Because they digest their food faster when they're warm, right?
They have to get warm to digest their food. They have to be up in a certain temperature range to digest their food. They won't even eat until they're within that range. Yeah, this is a great example of a den tree for a black snake. So if you have trees like this on your land, you want to leave them. Leave them standing, because they're an incredible home for wildlife. And also, the animals that would want to eat the rat snake would live in the same tree. Owls and hawks would use trees like this. So the snake's going to have to be very careful, isn't he? He has to be careful when he comes out, when he basks on the limb, because he doesn't want to end up the lunch of an owl or a hawk. Very cool. All right, let's collect some data. Hey, one thing, girls, that's really cool. This is the first time he's been found in this tree. So one more spot to add to the map where Splinter spends his time. Let's see, so far we've found him in a big white oak over that way, about a quarter mile that way. We've found him in a white oak over this way. Oh, we got a theme going here. This is a white oak too. And a white oak over here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 white oaks so far. And they're big, old, hollow, horizontal limbs. We've also found him inside 1, 2, 3 different buildings on campus.
I remember that.
You remember that?
Yes, mm-hmm. I do.
Where there was like the other snake on this side.
The other snake, that was you guys, wasn't it? The snake that was crawling up the wall and one of you said, hey, there's a snake out here.
Yeah.
That was so cool. That's on YouTube, you can go see it.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Cool, all right, let's get the data collected. Okay, so it's been about 12 hours since we released Apollo the rat snake. And I've decided to come out and look for him this morning and just to see how far he's moved since his release at the Nature Center. Now, before I turned on the recording here, I did check to see if I could pick up his signal from the Nature Center, and it was very faint. So I drove down the road to this location, and it's a little bit louder. Okay, so it looks like he has moved past the warehouse up this direction and near the cabins, near the main central part of campus. Or I could be wrong. No, wait, there it goes again, okay. He might be in the barn, but signal just peters out right here. Oh, wait a minute. At least I'll check. I don't think he's here. No. Fading out way too much. That way. Suddenly the signal just jumped up a lot stronger. Over in here. Maybe he's in that tree. Maybe. Is it a hollow tree? There's another entrance at the bottom, but that doesn't mean it's not. Oh, wait a minute. Nope. It's very possible he's in this big white oak with the big horizontal limb. All right, I believe Apollo is in this big white oak with the top broken out. I can't say that 100% because I don't see him, but the signal, the radio signal, is saying he is in that tree or one of the adjacent trees. But since I have seen Splinter use white oaks with big horizontal limbs such as this on many occasions, well, there's a good probability that Apollo is going to do the same. He could be way up in the top of that tree where the sun's hitting the leaves. Getting some sun. Getting some squirrels and other rodents that would inhabit this tree. Well, I'll come back in a few hours and check again. So it's been a couple of hours since I last located Apollo. And I'm here with Charlie, and Charlie is going to lead us to Apollo. And then we're going to see what he has done since we were last down there. We're going to see if we can find him, see if we can see him. So let's do it. Hold on, is it running? Yeah. Okay, off you go.
Rattlesnakes
are, but this is a rat snake. So rat snakes are not. And they eat rats and mice and squirrels and birds and bats and sometimes fish, rabbits.
I came up with a slogan for you.
A slogan? What's that?
Keith O'Neill is the real deal.
Oh, thank you. I guess that works for me. Oh, it's faded out. Get right over there and see if it changes. Somebody's really cool hat is all destroyed there. Hey, what do you think? Hold it more flat, you gotta kind of go this way.
Right there was kind of loud.
Yeah?
I think this one's the loudest.
I think you're right. Let me take a picture of it closer.
Yeah.
So it's your turn, you're number two. But remember, keep this down a little bit so it's level. If you have a question about level, see this little bubble in
here?
Yeah. And obviously the beef is pretty loud that way, so why don't you lead us? And we will find the snake.
Did you make that?
To some degree, I added some components.
It got quieter.
Well, keep in mind there's a kind of a ravine between us and the snake. There's also big trees. See how much it's getting loud again?
Yeah.
Okay. So kind of sweep to the left and right a little bit and see which way is the loudest. Wow.
This way.
Mm-hmm. But we're not going to be able to go that way. We're going to have to go down the trail here, but it will turn back to the left, and then it will take us that direction. So you lead the way. Like I said before, path of least resistance is a lot safer in these woods than just diving into the forest. See how it fades? It is sort of, it's in that quadrant.
That narrows it down.
Well, it does some. It really does some. And we could be getting what's called a bounce, where the signal comes from the radio transmitter in the snake if he's 60 feet up in a tree and goes over our heads and bounces off of a rock or a building. You know that big metal building over there? The signal could be going over there, bouncing off that building and coming back, confusing the heck out of us. But we'll know when we get over there where I found him earlier.
Okay, so we should continue this way.
Mm-hmm. Good. Follow the trail.
Yeah.
Probably the best bet. All right, so all you need to do is follow the loudest beep. And you can walk down the road, and hopefully the loudest beep will be off to the right or the left of the road. I don't know how far he's moved since I tracked him this morning.
Where was he this morning?
Just up the road here on the right in a giant white oak tree. We'll see if we can find him again.
Now, when we were at the barn, over in that general direction.
Yeah, you're right, exactly. So the road goes up, but then it turns back to the right and goes near the area where he is, where that signal is even telling us he is. So why don't we just follow the road, and we'll see if it gets louder.
Okay.
You lead the way.
That way.
You would be right. Well, from what I discovered at about 11:30, he probably hasn't moved far. So instead of going into the woods, we'll go this way because the trail curves right over there.
Okay.
And so you also have to think about what type of trees these snakes use. Small or large trees, and what we've talked about.
Large ones,
yeah. And they're usually hollow, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
And what are the, what's the limb structure like?
Horizontal.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a certain tree that they like specifically.
Yeah. Seems to be, so far with our study anyway.
It's that one that has, it's a little bit like that shape, but with a jagged.
Yeah, white oaks. They have lobed leaves instead of smooth. But they're not pointy, they're lobed. Right in front of you. And point up. You see that limb? See what we're talking about? What do you think?
He's up there. Oh yeah.
You found
him. He's up
him.
There.
Yeah. So good job, Izzy. You found Apollo's tree. At least for today. And if you look at this tree, girls, it's very descriptive of the type of habitat, at least in my study, that black rat snakes utilize here on this campus in this forest. Very big trunk, maybe, you know, 100 years old or so, and big horizontal limbs that stretch out. What's that?
You said it was a white oak?
This is a white oak, yeah. If you look at those leaves, they have smoothly lobed lobes on each leaf. The leaves are smoothly lobed and there's several of them. Whereas other trees like a black oak or red oak would have pointed leaf tips. So he's up there somewhere. He could either be laying on a limb outstretched in the sun or he could be inside a hollow. I can't tell if this tree is hollow, but I would have a good assumption that it probably is because there's a hole here, and I can touch some wood, but it seems awful damp, and that means it may be rotten on the inside, or not. It's hard to tell.
He could have climbed up this part of the tree.
He could have climbed anything here. He could have climbed this small tree over here. He could have went up this hemlock and then got onto that dead limb and went up the dead limb. You know, black rat snakes are excellent tree climbers. They don't need to have a hollow inside the tree to go up into the tree. All right, let's collect some data. Good job, girls. Okay, so we're tracking Splinter and Apollo again, and it is the 10th of September. So we're gonna go see if we can find them. What you do is you hold this level. If you tip it down or up, it won't work as well.
Yeah.
And you're gonna, every say 100 feet or so, you're gonna stop, and then you're gonna turn in quadrants. And you're gonna listen for the loudest beep in those in that quadrant when you turn.
Okay.
Whichever one's the loudest, that's where you go. There we go, off you go.
Hearing a faint beep.
Mm-hmm. I think this metal building might be interfering with our signal.
Yeah.
I wish I could.
Oh yeah, it's getting much louder down here.
Oh, listen to that.
That's louder.
Yep. Oh, well. That way,
definitely.
For sure.
Somewhere
in that bush.
Yeah, I'm gonna guess.
Somewhere. Well, no, it's not that strong yet, but. See, I just shifted it down into an even less sensitive mode called attenuator, and we've got the attenuator turned all the way up, which means it's a little more sensitive than it could be, and it's still not pegging it all the way to the right. If we were really close, like in that bush, this little bar graph would be going all the way to the right, and the beep would be really loud. Mm-hmm. But watch. fades, beeps. You know where I think he is? The barn.
Oh, yeah, that barn down there.
Let's go this way and check out the barn.
That barn.
And off you go.
Yeah, I think he's in the barn.
Hold on, slow down. Are you getting a louder beep? I don't know. Now I'm beginning to wonder if he's in the barn. But if he was in that barn, it would be beeping really loud right now. But let's go check anyway. He may be in the smaller barn down beyond the big barn.
Yeah, that smaller barn down there?
Yeah.
No, it's getting faint.
Oh,
there we go.
Oh, that kind of hurt my ear.
Yeah. Okay, now let's walk past the barn, and if the signal gets louder, we know he's not in the barn. If it gets quieter, we know we have to go check out the barn. Point it at the barn. Nothing. Keep going. It's not in the barn.
I don't think that's looks like a...
Ooh, you hear that?
Oh.
Keep going.
I have a feel. Oh.
Well, I don't know.
All right.
Keep going.
Wait.
Slow.
I have a thing. If you listen to there,
yep.
It might be in that wood pile.
Hold on. Let me adjust this a little. Got it. Okay.
I think. Do you want to check that pile really quick?
Sure. Walk over there. I might as well.
Just gonna go a little slower. Wait.
Watch where you step. Might be a snake on the ground. You see how the sun's hitting this area?
Mm-hmm.
A little bit, even though it's not real sunny. Yeah. He would probably be right on the edge of the clearing here trying to get some sun since it was a cool night and a cool morning. Okay, stop just a second. Now spin around. Oh, nope, he's that way.
Let's see, you want to check the small
one? Oh, he's lighter than that.
Yeah, hold on. Point it right at the loudest beep. Your bar graph, you know, it goes up to the right.
Mm-hmm. He's in there.
But where?
A little afraid of going in there.
Wait a second. I know what you mean. I don't want to go in there. You're good. Okay, so it looks like he's possibly in all this vegetation here, so I'm going to go around and bushwhack in, leaving the guys back here where it's safe, and see if I can find him. This is the garden from this year. It's all grown up. There's a few beans left.
I feel like he's right here.
Oh, I see his scales. He's right here. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to catch him, pick him up. Hope he's alive. He could have been eaten by something and it's just a part of his body laying there, but hopefully he's alive.
Did he bite you?
Uh-uh. Here he is. Ooh. Calm down, Splinter.
Does he bite?
You've never tried to bite me or anyone. There he is. Whoa. This is the first time we've seen Splinter in probably a month.
Wow.
And I bet he was down here warming up since this area is got a lot of good solar exposure, as you can see. A lot of good sun. And he looks really healthy. I don't see any injuries on him. Trying to see his incision site where we implanted the transmitter. Thought we did it on
his
right.
Hi, Splinter.
Yeah, I don't see it. I can't even see his incision site. Is this really Splinter? Yeah, there it is. That's his incision site, and it's totally healed up. Pretty amazing. Okay, if anybody wants to come touch him, tell you what,
touch him.
Go ahead. Here you go.
Nice.
Yeah.
He won't bite, right?
He might bite, because any animal with a mouth can bite. Come on up and touch him if you want to. Cool.
Smile for the camera.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you want to touch him? You can. Mm-hmm. Just reach up.
I feel like he's
here, touch his body.
Nice, buddy.
Reach up where you can see it. The camera can see you. Go ahead. Yeah.
Sweet. Oh, yeah.
Isn't that cool?
It's like the other snake back there. the other one.
Exactly. All right, so I don't want to keep him up off the ground too long because it'll kind of worry him. So I'm going to let him go. So we're going to say goodbye to him. Let him crawl back down in here since he knows exactly where he is. Now, we've got to collect the data, the scientific data. That's the most important thing. It's really cool that we got to see him, but we got to collect that data because that's what helps us understand his movements, and that's what therefore helps us protect his species. So, let's do that. Cool. Good job, guys. Okay, I've got to get Splinter's body temperature, and I shouldn't have let him go so quick, so trying to find him again so I can use my infrared thermometer to get his temperature. Really? Oh, there he is. He's over here. He's crawling. 69.7, 70, and 70. There he goes. See you later, Splinter. Now that is a beautiful snake. Magnificent creature. All right. Okay, so now let's go find Apollo.
You missed.
Might be covering up something for us here. Yep, it is. Okay, now spin around. Oh wow, still really loud to the right, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. I think we need to head up the road, circle around the waterfall, and then down the other road towards Gnome's Crossing and see if we can find him. I think he's still up in there.
Might be in the river taking a bath.
He might be, or fishing.
Becca saw a water snake on the step, you know, kind of right there.
Huh? Did you really?
He was like under the rock.
That big flat rock at the pavilion?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The step up there?
We've seen him before. He's pretty good size. Or she.
It's ladder right here.
Is it? Let's go to the road.
Here.
Watch him be on the dock.
Oh, that'd be neat.
I can't really hear it.
Okay, while you're over the bridge here, point down the street. Does it get louder?
Not really.
Can you hear it?
No. No. Yeah,
well, let's keep going. Oh, wait. It's on attenuator. Now point. Oh, yeah. Now point downstream. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep going up this way. Are you sure it's a lifetime?
Yeah, me and him might be grady next week.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, congratulations. He could be up in the top of some of these rotos right up in here. Very possible.
Roto snake.
Roto snake. Or if you look over there, see that hollow tree?
Yeah.
He could be in there. It's pegging it. Listen to it. Just bam, bam. Nope. He's not up, he's down. He's on the ground. Okay, there's a big pile of debris here. This is where he is, somewhere in all this stuff. This really is a wild snake chase. Hey guys, go back up the hill, hang a left, and come down to where I am. He's somewhere in this area, but it's a lot easier if you come around. He's somewhere. Right in here, but I just can't find him. Maybe he doesn't want to be found. I suppose if I had humans chasing after me all the time, I wouldn't want to be found either. Pretty cool place back in here, though. Take a look at where I'm walking. I'm right down here, guys. What I want to know is, what is he doing down here on the edge of the creek, other than coming to get a drink of water? Saying he's right in front of me. I hope I'm not getting a bounce. That would be a very embarrassing bounce. Okay, I'm gonna try a different tactic. I'm taking the radio off of the antenna again. Ouch. And trying to locate him that way. Okay, I am still getting a beep, so that means I am very close. Guys, look up and see if he's in the plants above my head. He might just be coiled up in one of these rotos. Kind of keep scanning around looking for him.
Because there's a hole in this tree.
Where?
There's a hole in this tree.
Is there really?
Oh, geez, yeah.
Let me see here. Hang on.
What color is he?
Solid black. No, I think he's down here. When I narrow the signal down, I turn it way down, pointing at the tree, and it fades out, but then I point it back down here, and it gets a little louder. Yep. Okay, what I'm gonna have to do is get my flashlight and peer under this glob of vegetation that looks kind of spooky. You know, no telling what's under there, but it might be him. So here we go. I'm gonna look and see if I can see him. Oh, guess what I just found? I didn't find the snake, but I found a hole in the ground.
Ah.
A snake-sized hole. It's possible that's where he is. I'm doing a little more poking around.
Are you gonna, like, reach him a hole?
No. It's not that big of a hole. But it's big enough for him. So, let me look one last time with my radio. Not really very loud down here. It's really not that loud down here. I thought it would be, but it's not.
the hole.
He's down in the hole, I guess. Somewhere in there. I guess we're just going to have to call it, or we'll just be digging around there for hours. Sometimes you just got to say, okay, he's in this area. Can't see him, but he's in this area. He could be up in some tunnel 20 feet up under the ground. So that's what we're going to have to do. Just call it.
So we're going back to your place now?
I got to collect the data first. Yeah. So yeah, he's in this area somewhere. And look at this spot, guys. Remember where Splinter was? How he had some sun falling on his area where he was, you know, able to lay out in the sun? Well, Apollo here is in the same kind of spot. He can lay out on this vegetation, and I would bet he was probably laying out here on this tied up, tangled up mass of twigs right here before we came up, getting some sun. All right, well, sorry I wasn't able to bring him out and show him to you, but that's how it goes sometimes. You got to see Splinter, though. That was cool, wasn't it? Cool. Okay, so we're out tracking Splinter, the black rat snake, again today. It's been 3 days since I last located him, and on the last time I located him, take a look here, some footage from that day that I shot with my cell phone camera. I just happened to walk out in the woods and find him in a place really close to the nature center that I was not expecting, and I didn't have any gear other than this receiver and my camera. So take a look at that now. Okay, he's directly in the center of the field of view, so I'm going to zoom in. See him there? Stretched out on that tree limb. And directly to the left, that big oak. Hard to see, but yeah, let's see if I can move over. You see the hole? I would bet that is a den that he uses at night for sheltering. And, of course, for hunting inside that tree. Let me see if I can get a better view. Okay, so I'm going to give you an overview of the site. I'm standing in a mixed hardwood forest about 100 yards from the nature center, about 50 or so feet from a small spring to my left. We're looking at a large white oak, not as big as the ones I've found Splinter in before. But yet it is a large white oak with cavities inside. I can tell just by looking at some of the holes in the tree that there is definitely some hollows in this tree. And to the right of the tree, we have a dying hemlock tree that's been adversely affected by the hemlock woolly adelgid. So let's move in. As I move in, I'm going to zoom in. Move up, I'm sorry. As I move up, I'm going to zoom in a little bit. Okay. And also you'll notice this tree has several knots, just like the other trees where I have found Splinter. There's one now. Sort of places where limbs may have fallen off and then the tree healed. Now you can see Splinter to the right. If you go up the white oak, there is a knot sticking out. And to the right of that knot, or maybe an old limb scar, I'm not sure the correct term for that, it points directly at Splinter laying on the hemlock limb. Now there he is. Trying my best to be steady with this camera. Going on up the white oak just to give it a good survey. Very similar to the other ones in that it does have a lot of small holes going into the trunk, cavities, in other words, places where a snake like Splinter could take shelter. All right, really good stuff. Okay, my hypothesis is that he's on that tree limb now, simply because it was a very cool night in the high 50s, and he's catching some good afternoon sun up on that tree limb, warming himself up. Okay, now in this angle, you can see Splinter on the tree limb. He's right in the middle, that black silhouette on the limb there, directly across. There's a hole. I'm not saying that is his den, but it sure is big enough for him to crawl into that tree and take shelter if he could fit in there and coil up, which I would bet he could. So I'm going to come back here soon, in a few days, and try to investigate this further. Very cool stuff. And then, now let's go find him today and see how far he's moved from that last location.
Showers.
Yep. I remember that. Okay, guys, I think he's still in the same location. So, I want you guys to follow me single file. Right through the woods here. Single file. You see that big oak there?
Uh-huh.
That's his tree, and if you go up the tree about 25 feet or so, 20 feet, you see there's a hole.
Yeah.
Kind of angled that way. We're gonna go a little closer, see if we can see him. He could be on the ground. Watch where you step. That's why I want you in a single file line. Start looking up in the branches, see if you see him laying up there. I don't see him yet. Okay. Yeah, he's in that tree. So what I'm gonna try to do, I'm gonna try to climb up this scraggly little old hemlock and take a look in the hole. Because if you look up, there's a hole. Can you see that hole up there?
Yeah.
Okay. That it's about 4 inches high, 2 inches wide.
Oh yeah.
That hole, he was directly to the right of it, stretched out on that limb that's going off to the right. So it's possible he's in that hole, coiled up, taking a little nap, waiting for the sun to get a little higher so that he can come out and bask. Okay, so what I'm going to try to do is climb this tree and look in the hole and see if I can see Splinter. Hope I don't fall.
Bye, Andy.
Bye, Bravo.
Bye, Andy. Good
luck, dude.
Thank you.
Oh my god.
Climbing.
Are they gonna race him like 250?
You know it's
on. Mm-hmm. They like an electric class.
Dude, that's so sick.
Of course I got the
damn, he got out that bitch.
Oh, hey guys, don't try this at home.
We already do.
I mean, Andy.
We tried it, true.
There's the hole. I'm almost there.
Bye, Bravo.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, crap. He's in the tree.
That's not healthy.
That is so sketchy. Oh, that is so sketchy.
Notice I'm keeping two hands in contact with the tree at all times.
I would die last.
Or two hands. Two points of contact. Trying to keep three, I'm sorry, not two.
That fish is all the way up there. That's all the way on the top.
Can't see anything.
If this freaking snake like falls,
there's nothing in the hole.
I will flip.
Don't you have a flashlight?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I want to be tied in. Okay, so here I am up in the tree and I'm about to look in the hole. Well, holes, there's two back here. You can see behind me. Let's take a look. Alright, I don't really see what I don't know what the camera's recording. There's something down in there, but I can't tell what it is until we can put this up on a bigger screen and look. It could be a snake coiled up. Could just be a dark area of the tree, of the rot inside the tree. Now I'm panning up, looking up higher into the tree, because he could be coiled up there. I can see anything the camera's looking at, but it is in night vision mode. Now I'm gonna come over here and look in this hole. I have no idea what the camera's seeing because I can't look. All right, this is actually kind of tricky, guys, so don't try this at home. Hey, guys.
What's good?
Hey, Steve. What's up?
Yeah. 700 feet.
All right, I'm heading down now. But no snake. But hey, I had to look. Okay, so we're not able to visually locate Splinter, but take a look at this. Really strong signal. And if you look up there, there is another nice big cavity that I could not investigate because it's so high. So I would bet that he is inside the tree right now. This is my guess anyway, my educated guess, is that he's still inside the tree waiting, and he'll probably come out very soon to warm up after that nice cool night. It was in the 50s last night. And I think he's gonna be coming out soon to thermoregulate. Maybe we'll come back in a few hours and see if we can find him. Good job, guys. Okay, so Splinter has moved. It's been 2 days and we're looking for him again. And he's moved not too far away from the tree that we found him in, but we still haven't found him. We're looking. You see this, like, the stump right here? This stump has holes in it. Okay? I bet he's down underground under this stump. Pretty faint. Got a little bit of a beep. A little hint. Right in here, hear it?
Mm-hmm. He's around here somewhere.
Yeah.
He could be really deep.
He could be deep.
He could be inside that thing.
That's what I'm thinking.
Make him tie this.
Another possibility, he was eaten by an owl and the transmitter's just laying on the ground somewhere. Huh. Under some leaves. See, now it's all faded.
That'd be funny and messed up at the same time.
It happens. Now look at that, look at that. I walk over there, it fades out. I walk over there, it fades out. He's underground right in here. No. We just want to know where he is. We're not going to bother him. Does that look like a hole going underground right over there, guys? See that little piece of, like, stump?
Yeah.
Does it?
Sort of.
No, it fades there, too. But it sure looks like one.
It's definitely a hole.
Yep.
There's holes all up in the stump.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's a deep hole.
Is it?
Yeah.
Mm-mm. He's down. He's underground. It's just a matter of finding exactly where. I'm thinking he's deep, like right in here. See how loud it is here compared to
here? How deep can they get?
Depends on how far down those tunnels go. All right, so I'm gonna say he's underground in this area underneath this big oak.
Parking.
Yeah.
So we have to do like all that information.
Yeah, I need to collect info. Okay, so I'm on the trail of Apollo the rat snake now. And the signal that I'm getting is putting him over in the area where I found him a week or so ago, down near the creek. It's just very faint. Looks like I have a little bit of walking cut out for me here. Just very faint. Aha. Look up in that really big oak there, that huge red oak. Do you see the cavity? There's a hole, pretty good sized hole. I believe he's in that tree. Okay, it's a good thing I brought my Sony Handycam, because I used the zoom feature to zoom in on that limb and I found him. There he is. I'm having a lot of trouble keeping this camera steady, but I do believe that that is our snake. Sure looks like a rat snake from here. That is amazing. He must be 80 feet up in that tree. Okay, I'm going to walk under the tree again and see if I can see him from another angle. Take a look at this. It's a very big tree. And, you know, it's interesting that he is on a horizontal limb. Just like in all of the other big trees that I've found both of these large rat snakes in. What a huge tree. Okay, let's go check it out. Okay, I'm looking up from below now, but I can't make out a snake. Okay, so there's the cavity. And then if you come out a few feet out the horizontal limb, there he is. It's the best picture I can get of him. He's just out there trying to catch as much solar radiation as he can. And undoubtedly, to me, I mean, I have no proof, but I would say that that is his residence while he is in this tree. Now just take a look at how immense this tree is and how far above the ground he is. He is at least 60 or 75 feet up in that tree. I mean, I can't get the entire tree in the frame of this camera. It's so big. All right. He has not moved very far from his last location a week ago. Probably about 150 yards that way. All right. We'll come back in a week and check on these guys. Okay, so I'm tracking Master Splinter, the rat snake, again. I'm getting a faint signal in that direction. A week ago, we found Splinter underground in the area of this old stump. But now the signal is pointing over into the woods here, it looks like. Very strong here. Maybe he's under this rock. This rock does have lots of holes under it. Okay, he's either on the ground or directly above me, but this sure is pointing to... Oh, there he is. Check him out. Right in front of me on the mountain laurels there. Beautiful. He's in a head down position. He's probably hunting. Check him out there. Hey, Splinter, how are you? Very cool. He's freezing, hoping that I'm not going to see him. He's probably doing a little bit of hunting and basking. Looks really good. It's the first time I've seen him this close in about, what, 3 weeks? When we found him in the garden? Okay, there he is. Now I'm gonna get my equipment and try to get his temperature really quick before he crawls away. Oh wait, here it is. Had it in a different pocket. Okay, I don't want to hit the plants too much. So here we go. Make sure this thing's working. It is. 67.3 and 67.3. Okay, so Mr. Splinter is 67.3 degrees Fahrenheit. And so that tells me the reason he's here is most likely thermoregulation, because the sun has just left his position as it's setting. And so he was probably up here grabbing as much sun as he could. Where is he sheltering here? Well, there's so many options. The rocks that we walked in over, big cracks going through them, holes underneath. He could be staying under the rocks, or it could be that he is staying in one of these large trees at night. It's hard to tell. I've been standing here about 10 minutes collecting data on Splinter, and I'm only a little more than our arm's length away, and he has not moved. He's not even flicked his tongue as far as I can see. I think he's just content to sit there and hope that I don't notice him. He's using the fact that he's not moving as camouflage, hoping that I'll just think he's a dark-colored stick and just walk on by. Okay, so Splinter has moved over 260 feet to the west in a week from the location I showed you earlier on the side of the trail underground in that stump area. But we have everything we need for Master Splinter today. Okay, so I'm going to start back here at his tail. Give him a good look. Get any closer. Don't want to disturb him. I mean, you know, he knows I'm here. He knew I was here when I came walking up around the bend over there. Oh, he's moving a little bit. Just a little. So I'm going to back off. I don't want to disturb him anymore. I want him to go about his business. Do what he has to do to get ready for hibernation, because the days are getting cooler and shorter, and soon he will be moving into his winter quarters, wherever that may be. It may be here in this area. There are a lot of big flat rocks under the leaf litter here. This may be a communal den site for rat snakes. It may also be communal for not just rat snakes, but other species of snake. Only time will tell. You know, one thing that's really interesting is, I just want to point out, is how close I was able to walk to him without even seeing him because of his camouflage. So that makes you think, you know, every time you're walking in the woods, you could be passing a 6-foot black rat snake just chilling out like this. That's just so cool. All right, see you later, Splinter. Keep up the good work of keeping everything in a balance. Okay, so we're tracking Splinter again today, and today we have some special guests, And Kevin is one of those guests. And before we went out to find Splinter, we Kevin actually saw one of my tin sheets and said, hey, look, a sheet of tin, can I flip it? And I said, of course. So Kevin's like, goes over, flips the tin, and check out what he found.
Got a milk snake here.
That's a beautiful milk snake. Wow. And it looks like a girl or boy. What do you think?
I would say boy.
I'm thinking the same thing. Without even doing a count on those caudal, subcaudal scales, he kind of has a little swelling there and a longer tail. Good find. That's the second eastern milk snake of this year. Really good find.
Not very aggressive either.
No.
He has a good way with him about snakes, to where he has always, you know, handled snakes in a way they seem to kind of calm down.
Yeah, I still wouldn't do that with a timber rattler.
No,
no thanks. Now, if we find Splinter the rat snake, you're welcome to pick him up if he's in a position where we can pick him up. He's often 80 feet up in oak trees. Very cool. But do you want to let him slide back under that piece of tin?
Yeah.
Because he was warming himself nicely.
He'll go back underneath her if he's gonna.
Yeah. Here he goes.
There he goes.
I'll have to come back and check later and see if he's still here.
You want to flip the other piece of tin that you said?
Yeah, there's one right over here to the right.
It's right here. Bring your stick.
Yeah, grab a stick and I'll stand back and see if you see anything. Hey, look, a salamander.
Slimy.
Is it a slimy? It is a slimy.
Come here.
Yeah, sweet.
There you go.
There he is. Cool. Look at that little slimy. Beautiful. And that is the first slimy to come from that piece of tin also. Beautiful salamander.
What do you got now?
Slimy salamander.
Oh, wow. Wow, he's big out too.
No, wait a minute. Is that a slimy or a Jordan? That's a slimy.
Good finds. In like, what, 10 minutes you found
a
milk snake and a slimy salamander. How cool is that? All right. All right, it's snake tracks again. We're tracking Splinter the rat snake, and it's been four days since I last located Splinter behind me here in the woods on the bush. So I've got some assistants here today. They're going to help me find Splinter. And we'll see what he's up to. Here we go. It's all you, man.
Okay.
The camera does create some interference with the radio.
Okay.
Don't know why, but okay.
Okay. Good.
Very loud right over in there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Keep on going down the trail.
I think he's more in that area.
They said they saw it this morning over in here.
Really?
Yep.
Well, that's cheating.
Well, they said they saw a big black snake.
Thank
I must you. Have ran right past him. He's
Down.
Somewhere right in this area, open area where the sun's hitting a bit.
Yeah. Now it says. Yeah, it's
slow. Swing it real slow. You want to kind of. See how the sun's hitting in here? I wouldn't doubt if he's right. Here.
Right there.
Yeah, let's go down the trail a little and then hook back to the right and kind of point it back up into this area, this sunny area. Oh, yeah.
He's so eye trained on seeing stuff.
I know.
That other people don't see. It's kind of weird to try to do it a different way.
You've always had great eyesight and seeing stuff. He's got it too.
Now, try it.
He's never had it whipped out of him, which what most parents ruin their kids. They come with all this ability.
Exactly. With instinct.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Sounds.
Let's go around, down and around this little white pine and go up into the woods a little bit. Right in here, but watch where you step, because there's yep. other indigenous life forms, what they've been saying. Okay, where's the beak now? Still kind of this way, right?
Oh, there he is.
Oh, hey. Oh, man, what's up? Hey, guys, we got him on the ground over here. Oh, and I got to get this out and film what he's doing. So there he is. I don't want him to go up this tree. Okay, come here, buddy. Here you go. Hold him. Grab him. He's really nice. He might bite, but usually not. There you go. That's Splinter.
Yeah.
He'll chill out in just a minute. Yeah, that's Master Splinter, as we call him. Be real careful with his rear third. That's where his transmitter is located. I would kind of get him up closer to you. He probably won't bite. There you go.
He musked on me.
That's a first.
Yeah.
He loves you.
I think it's because we surprised him. Now, if he bites, shouldn't be any big deal because he is a rat snake. He'll let go. Very cool. You're the first person to hold him in about a month.
He's cool. Smelling. Like,
yeah.
Checking you out, man.
This is a very interesting snake. His story goes basically that last November, almost a year ago, we found him just outside the back door of the nature center, laying on the ground right near the solar array. And I picked him up. He was real chill. He let me hold him. Didn't seem to care. And I thought, yeah, he's a big snake. We can put a transmitter in this guy and track him and learn about his life. And kept him over the winter. Let him hibernate in the nature center. But before that, we did a surgery on him, put a transmitter in his belly, and discovered that he had a huge load of internal parasites. So we treated him for, I think it was four different species of parasites. Got rid of all his worms. Also, he has a swelling on his left upper lip area.
Yeah.
And treated him for that as much as we could with some antibiotics. And when we let him go this spring, he was eating out of our hands, literally. He wouldn't even constrict. He would take a mouse gently and swallow it, and he would eat like six mice at a time. So we bulked him up, got him healthy, let him go, and we've been tracking him ever since. And notice this tree he had just seemed to come down from. It's a white oak, isn't it? Yeah. It's a white oak with... it doesn't have any horizontal limbs. It has this oddly shaped limb, but I would say this tree probably is hollow. It may have some cavities in it. I could be wrong, but all the trees I've found him in association with, and I could have just been passing by this tree, but he has used several large old white oaks, hollow, lots of cavities, and big horizontal limbs high up in the trees. It seems that this snake and the other one I'm tracking, which is the same species and about the same size, gravitate towards that kind of a tree. So that shows how these kinds of trees are so important to wildlife, even if it's just this species of wildlife.
Almost looks like a cavity right up there. That second notch. Kind of.
Yeah, there may be one up there. And see all these little knots? Also, the trees I've been finding him in have knots like that, little protruding...
Holds to climb with.
Exactly. Good holds for climbing. Yeah. Very good find, man. And that was the third time we found him on the ground. Every other time we've located him since May, he's been in the trees. And sometimes 80, 100 feet up. The other day when we found him, he was just over near that big dead oak about 100 feet away. Very cool. All right, let's let Splinter go. But wait, before we let him go, I need to take his body temperature. Then we'll let him go and do some data collection, because that's the most important thing. Finding the snake is cool, but the data collection is the most important thing, so we can help him. All right, so I'm going to take the temperature of Splinter. Infrared thermometer, thank you, Jim Hardy. 71.1, 70.9. Okay, it keeps changing. 69.8, 69.1, 73. So he's around 70 degrees. All right, now, if you want to let him go, I would let him go right at the base of the tree where he was headed, because he okay. knows exactly where he is.
Before he runs away.
Yeah, please do.
You got a GPS, Steve?
Yeah.
Where is your GPS?
Buried in there, in the main pocket. Welcome to move the GoPro and get more footage of them if you want to.
Okay.
This is day 22. We haven't been tracking them very long. Super interested in what kind of data I'd get. Here he is. Here he is. You know, have you guys ever thought about this? You're a snake. Your head is that big, and acorns of the size are bigger than your head are falling around you. How did you deal with it? You hide, I guess. Okay, so we're tracking Mr. Apollo today, and I have a group helping me find him, and it happens to be...
Charlie!
Good job, Charlie. And we're going to go find Apollo now, and I'm going to let Charlie do the tracking. Everybody else follow me. Okay, don't make weird noises, because that means I have to do more editing and edit out all the weird sounds.
Wait, shh, I have to listen to the beeping.
What's that?
It's getting quieter.
Okay, keep going. We'll go a little further, and we'll adjust it. Now, look how loud that is. Yeah.
It's in a tree.
I think he is in a tree, but he's that direction. So, keep
this
going
way?
Down the trail. Yeah, he's that way.
He's that way.
Well, what we're going to do is go down the trail and circle around through Bravo Camp, and then we can go down a little trail in the woods there. So, yeah, let's just keep going this way. I think she's right.
Well, I know what I'm doing.
You do know what you're doing. And keep your eyes on the ground also, because Splinter could be crossing a trail up here. Since we know he's just right up here near Bravo Camp.
Mm-hmm.
And he might curl up in a sleeping bag of one of you tonight, so keep your
oh
eyes
Oh, God.
Open. Well, he doesn't bite.
No, he's really nice.
It's getting kind of louder.
It is.
No, it's quieter.
Oop, oh. Out. Yep, it is. Listen out. Really get me out. He might be right down here.
Uh-huh.
You want to say?
Like a check mark.
It's this way.
See how I'm narrowing it down?
Yeah, it's still going all the way up.
Okay, you can go all the way to the tent, and then we'll let somebody else do it.
All right.
Yeah, tilt it down just a little bit, like that. Yeah, kind of horizontal. There you go.
When we walked past here, it went down.
Hmm.
It
was... Well, we'll see what happens when we get in this clearing.
Yeah, it's fading.
Let's see, it's back here.
There's no attack. Chase my back.
I don't know. It's still kind of loud, though.
Right down in here.
I'm trying to get that. No, I'm getting this more in the sun. It's just my brain.
It's kind of loud, isn't it?
Yeah, you're like checking to see if there's any attack.
fades out there. Fades out. That yurt.
It's yours. Okay.
It's
probably like the wood.
Good thing you're doing this.
Yeah. Who wants to go next?
Okay.
Cool. Here you go.
Don't
hit that wire there. Watch out. There you go.
I'm too tall for the wire.
I was gonna say.
I almost closed on myself yesterday.
Uh-oh. Okay. I'll crack down here and then turn around and see what you get.
Where?
Seems like it's fading out, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Here.
Here somewhere.
Awesome.
Yeah, we passed him. Where is he?
I was thinking that too, the wood pile of the pack.
Not the wood pile.
Is it the pack?
Not the pack.
It's probably in a tree up here.
That's cool. Ah. Now we're getting somewhere.
Oh, wait. Okay. It's getting quieter. It's getting louder this way.
Louder than to the right or the left?
To the right.
Let's see.
Wait, look at the scanner thing.
Yeah, see this little...
Uh-huh.
Oh, it's so loud.
Well, here's what we need to try. Going up the trail a little bit and see if it drops all the way off.
It's definitely getting quieter. It's down to like three of those things. Yeah, if you look,
right.
It only does three.
Yep.
Yeah, it's definitely. It's that one.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so I've sent the group around. And I'm going to come through this way. I just didn't want them trekking through the woods where there could be a rattlesnake. It's that time of year. Look at that, bear scat. A bear's been here. Oh, where is he? That way. Yeah. Could be in this huge tree right beside me. Big hemlock knocked down in a big storm. Let's try something here. Whoa! Mud just about fell. Yeah, look where I am. He's somewhere nearby. Yeah, it is. Just the question is where? He might be in that barn. Very possible. I think I just disturbed the yellow jacket's nest. Something just crawled on my finger but didn't sting me. Whew, it's loud. It's possible he is in here. He might be in the barn. Or not.
Oh. Right there.
Where?
Right there. Chilling right there.
Oh, check it out. There is a snake. Good spotting.
Baby.
It's a little ringneck snake.
I just look over and I'm like, oh my God.
It's not the actual snake we're looking for,
know, but
that's the, what are the odds of that? Hey, look, there's a snake. There he is. Oh, it's not the right one, but there
he
is.
Like, almost touched it too.
Good job.
I'm like, oh, there's a snake. I know, I was looking for an acorn and I was like, oh, there's a snake.
It's like he's right here.
He's chilling.
All right, so we've crossed over to the other side of the creek. Getting a loud, very loud signal now. Oh yeah, I think he's still there. Do you see that big oak with a hole in it?
Yeah.
That's where he was on Friday of last week.
And I'm, is he inside the tree?
I think he's in that tree. Let's see if we can see if he's on that limb.
Did we find him?
Yeah, I think he's still in that big tree. You see this big oak here?
I don't know what an oak is.
Well, it's that really tall tree with the hole in it up near that horizontal limb.
Uh-huh.
Last Friday, I came out here to locate him. And he was stretched out on that limb to the right of the hole. You could see him just plain as day. Now, I don't see him. That doesn't mean he's not there, but his signal is pointing to that tree. And this shows you why it seemed like he was so far over that way, remember?
Yeah.
All the way in Bravo Camp. Because if you were up on that tree, you could look right down into Bravo Camp, I would guarantee it. So, the signal is coming. He may even be higher. He may be way up there. That was funny. So he may be way up in the top limbs of the tree and his signal is transmitting out over the countryside, making it seem like he's all the way over there in Bravo Camp. And remember, we even got a strong signal at the Nature Center. So that's where Apollo is. He's still in that tree. What's that?
He's like a tower, like a cell phone tower, basically.
He's like a cell phone tower, exactly. He is up in that big oak again. It's been almost a week and he's still there. Of course, now think about it. Well,
he's a guy.
Yeah, thank you.
Maybe.
Okay, girls, really cool. So I'm going to come up there and we'll collect some data and talk about this a little more. Very cool. All right, so we're going to go find Splinter again. And this time I have a whole crew of, snake hunters to help me find him. And are you guys ready to go find Splinter?
Yeah.
Excellent. All right, so let's go find him. All right, Ellie, it's all you. Go find the, let's take us a little bit closer to the snake.
All right, so I'm looking for a snake. And, thank you. And so I'm supposed to stop every about 100 feet or so and kind of go in a circle and make sure I'm getting closer. So as I get up here, I'm gonna stop and do that.
Yell duck. Damn.
I hear it here.
Hmm.
Then I also hear it.
Seems a little loud to the right, doesn't it?
Yeah. It sounds louder right here.
It does. Mm-hmm. Well, let's go a little bit farther and just see what happens.
All right. So the snake we're looking for is named Splinter, after, because it's a rat snake, so it's named after the Ninja Turtles leader.
I guess Splinter? It's a rat nose. Right.
Yeah. Izzy guessed it. So, I've never really tracked a snake before. So this is pretty new and cool to me. So I'm gonna do the spinny thing again.
Y'all see that big white oak right there? It's that big tree with that big crooked limb that comes off. It's kind of over there. Mm-hmm. That he's been in that tree before. But notice how it's not really loud right now. I don't think he's in that tree now. It would be really loud. Let me see it for just for a second. I think he's that way.
He's that way. Science.
Wow.
Thank you. See, look how it faded. Oh, yeah. It's back. Hold on. All right, who wants to go next?
I'll do.
Bill, you did a good job.
Thank you.
Okay, hold, there you go, so this didn't tip.
I'm excited to hear my voice.
Well, you'll get to watch yourself when you get home.
It's now Alex, and I am leading us this way, and let's see if we can find the snake. It's hard to see where he's going, but we're trying to look for him, so.
I remember the one time when you kept giving us that box.
All right, Alex, stop right here a second. What do you got?
It's getting louder.
It is. I'm wondering if he is in a certain cabin. Ooh, it just got louder, didn't it?
Yep. It's getting louder.
Okay, now.
Science.
Whoa. Now rotate again.
You just...
Do you hear anything, Alex?
I'm still looking.
Oh, it's super muffled that night.
Okay, I'll tip it down just a little. You're kind of pointing too high. There you go, like that. See how it's really loud at this metal building?
Yeah.
That is me very interested. It could be a reflection off of the metal building. So let's walk over there, see what we get.
It's still, no, it's louder this way.
It is, but let's just verify it. So what we have to do is go over here and try it again. And if it fades out, we know to come back, right?
Oh my gosh, I feel special.
You are special, like Thanks. I said before.
Is the camera
Yeah, I think you're very special.
Thanks.
And you're very...
Okay, single file girl behind me. Simply because I have to help her with the adjustments.
So this is Izzy, not Ellie. I'm Isabel.
My name's better than yours.
Stop it.
That's why you said it.
That's funny.
This is Izzy now, and we're looking for a snake. Really? I didn't know that. I know.
No way, Izzy.
What do you think?
You're
point that
so
way, point that way.
Smart.
Thanks, Amara. I'm sure Izzy appreciates
way.
That.
Swing on.
You're right, go that way. All right, so now we've decided to start tracking Apollo because Splinter's signal faded out as we walked down the hill and Apollo's got very loud. So we're gonna go find Apollo now and then we'll double back and find Splinter.
Hello, subscribers up to YouTube.
All right, Amara, it's your turn.
Okay, so I'm just gonna go.
Now use your real voice.
Serious,
Serious is good.
Okay, so we're going to...
Now I can't get it normal.
So we're gonna go snake hunting. And it seems that we have to cross the creek. So...
My normal voice. Please. Another thing is, like, as you look, it's just... And it's October, so fall is just starting. And it's beautiful and the weather's perfect
you see
right
how pretty
now.
That looks? So please... Put your luck, give me your luck, because we're crossing this slippery
we're across the bridge. And when you're right in the middle of the bridge, spin around and see what you can find with the figure. Okay, so what are you getting? What are you getting? Louder that way?
Yeah. Spinning.
All right, so let me adjust it a little bit.
So we're going to
All right, so it's Ellie back here looking for Apollo now.
Says that's where they're from.
So that is Rodo. I learned that here in the North Carolinian woods. That Rodo is invasive.
It's invasive in some ways, but it is a native plant, so it's not bad. It just grows fast.
And we can cut it to make
bows.
Bows for bow drilling.
Or walking sticks.
Walking sticks and bow drilling is, I'm not ready to bow drill yet, but I'm super excited because it just seems super cool.
I'm ready to bow drill.
All right, can you squat, please?
Squat. Top of squat, people.
Ooh.
Can you hold my rock? I want to see my new
That's
strike.
A pretty rock.
I love your voice.
It's a new striking rock. Thanks.
This is a little small for a striking rock.
But I have a small hand.
That's true.
They're very small.
Watch out, don't trip on that big rock.
How old are you again, Alex?
11.
11.
Does Alex stand for Alexandria?
Alexandra.
Alexandra. That was close.
Ellie stands Alexandria, too.
Ellie stands for Ellie.
Oh, look!
What?
Ooh.
Oh, check it out. You know what that is? That is a tussock moth caterpillar, I believe.
Isn't that the one that irritates your hand?
Yeah, the little hairs, if they get in your skin or your eyes, could be very irritating.
Your eyes?
Well, yeah,
everywhere.
It could happen.
I was eating dinner, and then one just crawled on my hand, and I...
Well, they're not going to, like, hurt you or anything unless you bother them, so... It's a good idea just to not bother fuzzy caterpillars.
Oh, it's really loud.
Yeah.
Hear that?
Yep, it's probably up in that hole there.
Do you see the hole?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
That's his tree. Okay, and you see that horizontal limb stretching out to the right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the limb I've seen him laying on. Okay, so we are finished tracking Apollo, and now we're looking for Splinter again. So, who would like to... All right, Amara, it's your turn. Whose turn is it?
It's Izzy's.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Well, then, we'll just go in the order we have been.
Okay.
Go, Izzy, go.
Okay.
Watch out, don't trip on that.
Oh, we're in the wild.
We're in the wild. And it's Izzy again.
It's loud this way. Whoa!
It's loud, louder that way, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Let's check. I'll turn this down a little. Okay, see how loud it is there? Now point back behind you. Yeah, you're right. Then will you lead the way?
A gnat just flew in my mouth. 0.001 grams of protein.
That's really gross.
0.001. How do you figure that? Did you have a little scale?
No, I just
did. Yeah.
What?
Okay, so we found Splinter. He's crawling across the ground. He's right over here. Y'all stay right there. Don't anybody come closer. I'm going to get some video of him. So here's Splinter on the ground. I think, you know what I think, girls? I think he was in one of these cabins or in one of these trees when we were walking by earlier, and that's why we were getting that signal. This is just really awesome to see him laying out on the ground like this right here in front of everybody, isn't it? Okay, now what I gotta do is get a still shot of him. You wanna hold it? Don't move it, but keep it really steady, just like this. Kinda right about here. Now, keep it real steady. Walk around here and try to get a picture of him, and maybe he'll do what rat snakes do when they're threatened. Although he's typically not that threatened by people because he knows us pretty well. Keep real still now. When rat snakes are threatened and they think they're gonna be in danger, they'll kink their body up to look kind of like a dead stick. And that's kind of what he's doing now, but as I get closer, he may kink up more. And scientists think that the kinked body and the black coloration makes animals like hawks that are flying over think he's a stick, and there's no reason to look further and think he might be food. So they leave him alone. Let's see what he does.
That is so cute.
All right, what I'm gonna do is take a picture of him with all y'all stand there looking towards us, towards me, and the snake, and I will get a picture of you guys together.
Okay, that looks pretty cool.
Whoever wants to be in the picture.
He's moving.
Kinking.
play a snake.
He doesn't like that, but he's still being a little. He's still not moving very much, is he? He's still keeping very still, hoping that I'll go away. Now he's moving a little.
He's like, what are you doing?
What if he strikes at you?
I'm not worried. He's not going to hurt me.
True that.
How do you know?
Because he's a rat snake.
He's so cute.
He's like, who are these people? Steve, every time you come and find me, you bring no people.
Mara.
But I need to get his temperature. Somebody remember this reading.
Did they say Fiesta 2?
72.3. Remember that. 71.8, 72, and 72.3.
I got 78.
Okay. Now see, part of this study is to try to figure out what black rat snakes do in heavily used human habitat. And this is a heavily used human habitat, as you can see. Cabins, storage buildings. More cabins.
People.
And of, yes, us, people. So here he is, out in the open, on the ground.
I call it.
In the middle of the day. He's obviously comfortable enough with people to just be out in the open like this, which is really cool. Now, if you're wondering, his transmitter, if you look back here, that's his, this little spot here is the suture incision area where the transmitter was put in his body. And it's a very tiny little device. I'll check him out. Check out his tongue. So girls, what's his tongue used for?
Smelling.
Right, he is smelling all of you.
He's smelling.
I smell good. I mean, I've been out in the woods for a couple weeks. Probably like the
You smell like the earth. He's not too concerned with us because he is used to the smell of humans. Because the smell of humans, he spent the whole winter in the nature center. And we fed him mice. Who knows, he might be kind of like, maybe they'll give me a mouse. I doubt it.
What did he do?
Look, he's in a defensive posture.
Does that mean he'll strike at you?
He might.
No offense, but I just kind of want to see him bite you.
Right? Like, just to see.
That's mean.
Me too, I'm a little bit interested.
Just to see what it looks like when...
No, just to see someone...
When he looks like when he's biting someone.
When he's
Have you ever been bitten by a cat? It's kind of the same thing.
Oh, only cats don't go.
Only cats bite much harder.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, sure. He's sniffing that twig very heavily. And what is it about this twig that is making him interested in it? Look at him. He's really sniffing this twig heavily. So I want y'all to notice again, okay, so here's Splinter, and he is right outside a cabin that he spent time in, right over there. Why is he leaving the cabin? I don't know. This is why we're doing the study. Well, maybe he's been in there a couple of days and already cleaned out all the mice.
Maybe it's because of the construction they're doing. Maybe
he Good observation. You're right. Maybe he wants to come out and just go somewhere new, but I think it might have something to do with the construction too. Because they're getting ready to put air conditioning in or heat in these buildings, and that means they're going to have to they pulled off the siding over there, if you notice that. They're going to have to put ductwork under the building. So he was leaving, probably trying to get away from that. All right,
I'm
so I'm going to pick Splinter up really quick. We're going to do this fast, one at a time. I'm going to come over here and let y'all touch him one at a time.
What about me?
You can just hold on to that, and you'll be the last one. How about that?
I'll
He's not going to like this. He might bite me. Never know.
Oh my god!
Okay, tilt the camera up
that
a little
just
more.
Oh, that's scary.
He's been handled by me before. Ooh. It might take a second for him to remember this feeling.
He's like, what is that?
Now look, see, he came right down to my hand, didn't bite me, because he remembered my smell most likely. That's my theory anyway, I don't know for sure.
Did he lick you?
Yeah, he just smelled my hand. That's see, I'm not restraining him. He can do what he wants. He's holding on with his tail. He's a little cool, because it was a cool night and kind of a cool day.
Bite him, bite him.
Oh,
really?
That's me.
Okay, so.
Really,
first person, come over and touch him really quick, because we can't hold him too long. Now, don't touch his head, just touch his body. Here, I want you to get a picture. He's going to get a picture. Here you go. All right, so we're going to let Splinter go right where we found him, right here on the ground, going towards that cabin. So follow me down. There he goes.
Go down a little bit.
Okay, thank you. Let's see where he goes.
Mm-hmm.
Head back.
Okay, cool.
Now he's going pretty quick.
How old do you think he is?
I'm guessing 12, maybe 15, somewhere in that area.
12 to 15.
Yep. He's moving quick. And he's probably going to go in the cabin or somewhere near it. Just don't step on his tail by accident.
Wouldn't he, like, turn around really quickly?
If he touched him, yeah. He would turn around to see what just touched his tail. He's a big snake, isn't he? And you can see why a hawk would want to eat him. That's one of their number one predators is hawks. Because they spend it there, you know, these guys are out during the day. And so, hawks are out during the day. Don't cross paths, don't go on the trail yet. We want to see where he's going to go. And so if he's laying out on a tree limb up high in the trees, then he would be easy prey for a hawk. Is he going to go over? Yeah, he's going to go over. I thought he might be going under it around it for a minute.
If a hawk ate it with the transmitter, would you be able to track the hawk?
The hawk would probably not eat the transmitter. It would eat everything but, and then, I mean, that is a great question. And then the transmitter would be found laying on the ground and no
around
snake.
Bloody guts.
Yeah, there would probably be some bones left over. Well, he's avoiding the cabin. Let's see what he's going to do here. Well, we're going to say bye to Splinter, and we need to go collect data for where we found him originally out in the yard. See you later, Splinter. We'll come find you later.
Bye, Splinter.
Bye, Splinter.
Good job, girls. We found both rat snakes. Good job.
Two, one.
Science!
Science.
Okay. Okay, so we're getting a faint signal in that direction. Very faint. It's been about a week and a half since we last located Splinter. So let's go find him. Okay, so it looks like Splinter is up in this red oak. I would say he's inside in a cavity. I can't prove that, but just based on my radio signal, it's pointing to this oak. He has moved about a tenth of a mile from the last location where we found him on the 8th, crossing the yard in front of one of the cabins down on campus. So it's also interesting to note that we're only about 100 yards to the northwest of the location where we found him basking about 3.5 feet above the ground in a mountain laurel about 3 weeks ago. He is still very close to the nature center. The nature center is about 150 yards that direction through the forest. So the question I have is he going to stay in this area or is he going to move to the area around the nature center where I found him almost exactly a year ago? It was early November, It is now getting to be late October, so where's he going to go? Will he move to the nature center and hibernate in the attic or under the floors? Who knows? Only time will tell. All right, so we're tracking Splinter again. It is October the what?
29th.
Okay. And we're looking for Splinter. He's somewhere over here in the woods. And I have somebody here helping me today. Who's helping me? Who are you guys?
Charlie!
Excellent. That was great. All right. And so Charlie's going to help me find Splinter again. And then hopefully if we have time, we'll go find Apollo.
Okay.
Listen, girls.
I'm sorry.
Listen.
Wait, I want some water.
How much louder it got?
Yes. Yep. He's over here. Everyone wants your stuff.
Okay, what do you think?
It's getting kind of louder, but then it goes kind of quiet.
Okay, well, do your little spin around and slowly and see which way's loudest. Did we pass him?
Pass him.
Maybe we did.
I think we did.
Try down there. Okay, let me adjust it.
It seems
loud here or there, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, look how it's dropped off dramatically just after passing this rock, right?
Oh my God, he's in the rock.
I think you're right. I think he's hibernating under these rocks, under this little area here. Oh yeah. And then what's really interesting about this spot, I found him on these mountain laurels about 3 weeks ago, just laying out on the mountain laurels in the sun. Huh. Yeah. So this may be where Splinter's gonna hibernate. Hold on just a second. Yep. Right here. Right in here. Okay, if y'all want to come up behind me over here to my right behind me here, be careful climbing the rock too.
I feel like hold on to him.
Watch where you step because he may be under the leaves. He could be on the ground getting ready for the sun to come up and then he'll climb up into those laurels like he did that time before. Literally where he was right there. About 3 weeks ago, he was just draped all over these mountain laurels. And the signal's putting him over here to the left a little bit. See, he could just be curled up under these leaves or literally right up here. No, look, it's real quiet when I point it up.
Chilling.
He's down here. I am gonna bet, this is my height, my thought, is he's either underground or...
Hole that he comes out of.
Yep, or he's under these leaves right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the radio, okay? I've taken the radio off the antenna, so I've removed the antenna, which lowers the sensitivity of the radio dramatically. So the only way it's going to beep is if I get it really close to the snake. Still, it's beeping, I can still hear it. And if he's in the leaves here, I should be able to pinpoint him. Yeah, I'm gonna check all around the base of that dead tree. Okay, y'all stay right there a second. Nothing? Oh, wait. Look what I've discovered. It's not a snake, but... Yeah, there's a hole right here that goes into the base of this dead tree.
He's in there.
Maybe. Hold on. Yeah.
Splinter! That's not Splinter.
Let me see. I'm going to go around the other side and check over there real quick. Making sure I test before I step because I don't want to step on him. Yeah, he's not on that side. One last thing. Tree itself. Uh-uh. Cool.
He's down there.
So, what I think has happened here is, I think he crawls into the hole at the base of that tree, or there's a hole in the top, most likely. It looks rotten. And then crawls down into the rotten root tunnels, because you know when the tree dies, its roots die also. Mm-hmm. And so there'll be little tunnels formed by those roots when they rot out. Mm-hmm. And he's probably in one of those root tunnels, or just curled up under a rock that we're on top of. We're on top of a bunch of big flat rocks. And as you saw down below, there's a crack that goes under the rocks. So that may be how he gets in, or like I mentioned before, possibly the hole that's down here at the base of this tree right there.
Can snakes see in the dark?
Splinter can't. He has to use, it's a good question by the way.
Do Splinter, they just kind of go forward and hope
well,
to
use their tongue?
Like exactly. They use their tongue to smell their way through the dark. If you had the ability to smell like a snake does, you could close your eyes and navigate as well. Think about a snake's tongue. It's forked.
Wouldn't you run into trees?
Well, no, because your tongue would tell you there was a tree right in front of you. What is it about the fork on the snake's tongue that makes it much different than our tongue and much more able to navigate with?
It, like, goes off in different directions, whereas, like, our tongue is just...
one direction. Their tongue is forked, so...
Oh, it's like...
Well, think about it. If you're following the smell of a pizza, to something you would relate to, and it was a dark room, and you're flicking your tongue, and just think about it, kind of like you use your nose, but yet 1,000 times more powerful. Don't you think the left side of your tongue that has, you know, the fork on the left side would pick up more particles from the pizza if the pizza was on the left?
Yeah.
There
so
you
it's
go.
Kinda, it's kind of like the antennas. It's like either totally direction it goes off to, right. It's like you move and it's closer on one side.
Right. It's a directional sense of smell. See, we do have a directional sense of smell, but it's not as sensitive as a snake's. Like, think about it. You walk into a house, and you go, ooh, I smell pizza. And you follow the smell to the pizza, right?
But with us, it takes longer because we can only do, like, one direction at a time, whereas, like, snakes can do, like, two directions at a time.
Right. And so one flick of their tongue will tell them the mouse is on the left, right? One flick is all they got to do. Flick it out. Oh,
but
mouse on the left.
But they can see in the light, right?
In the light, though, Splinter can see really well.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, he's an opportunistic predator. So, like, if it's daytime and he's hunting birds, he will look for the bird. He'll use his tongue as well. And then he'll use his sight to catch the bird as it tries to fly off the nest or whatever. But if it's nighttime and he's inside a big hollow tree or down underground like he is now, then he's going to use his tongue to navigate through those passageways. And as soon as he picks up the particles of, oh, say, a mouse that ran through there an hour before, he can follow that smell right to the mouse, even without his vision. Okay. All right, so girls, let's collect some data.
Golden.
It was golden. Good job. Okay, it's rat snake tracks again, and it is October 29th, and we're tracking Apollo the rat snake. And I have a whole crew here of snake trackers. Who are you guys?
Journeys!
Excellent. Journeys is helping us go on a journey to find Apollo the rat snake, so let's do it. Mitch?
Yeah?
It's your turn.
Okay.
Give somebody your journal.
Okay.
Let them hold it. And it's all you, man.
Okay. Because this trail leads to Bravo Camp, right?
That's right. And we'll go through Bravo Camp. Keep that flat. Can you hold this thing? All right, what's your name again?
Logan.
Logan, it's your turn. It's all you. Hold it like that and see what you get. Y'all stay behind Logan. Ooh.
Oh, this is really strong.
It is. I don't think he's in one of these trees, but let me just first, tell you what, find the strongest direction. So you're going to turn all the way around. That's real strong, wasn't it? Ah.
So right in this area.
You're right. Okay, stop. What do you got? Hang on just a second. Still really strong that way, isn't it?
Yeah.
And turn. Yep, see? Much louder. Cool. All right. Who's next? Good job, man. Yes.
Who's next?
Let somebody hold your journal.
It's his journal.
And... now it is your turn. So remember, hold under here so it doesn't flip up. And it's all you.
Like everyone, individual is like.
Seems to be strongest over in that area, doesn't it?
Like kind of near our yurt?
Yeah, so walk that way.
Toward the yurt?
Yeah, just watch your steps. You don't want to trip and fall. Pay attention to what your feet are doing and the ground is doing and the bead. Lots of stuff to pay attention to, isn't it?
Yep.
Can Apollo feel it?
Guys, single file.
Wait, can Apollo feel it when we check?
No, not until we get really close and he can feel our vibrations as we walk up towards him. That's pretty loud. You know, let me see that little bar graph. See the little bar graph right?
It was pretty strong when I was using it. It was like about 5 pixels up.
Ooh, it's faded out a little bit. See those little black dots there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now if you turn to the right a little. Ooh. I don't think he is where he was about a week ago. I think he's going to be in a new place. But we're not sure yet, so keep going down this trail. Really?
Oh!
What? What happened?
It just went up like real high.
Ah. Go a little farther.
It's okay. Even going past that thing.
Yep, let me turn this down a little. A little more. Abdullah, it's your turn. So, it's all you. We're just going to go up here and we're going to walk down the road and curve around. So, let's go that way.
Oh, I really want to see the waterfall.
And we're going to go right by it. Very good for you to watch it.
Let's stop. I can't even hear you.
See what you get.
Yeah, it's that way.
Good job. All right, your turn, man. What's your name again?
Brandon.
That's right, Brandon. Is it recording? Yes, off you go.
That's going to be a fun part of the video.
He's down in here. You see that big oak?
Yeah.
I wonder. There's holes in it. Okay, walk straight down in the woods there.
Oh, that's kind of smaller.
Is it?
It's bigger.
Okay, I'm gonna have to take over.
Okay.
Because we're getting close. Good job, everybody.
Hey, Steve, I told you about the den that's right over this way, didn't I?
Yeah, you did.
Back to the left over there.
It's over here?
Back that way.
Oh, back to the right.
Yeah, like,
You said you saw a black snake crawl into it, right?
Yep.
Ah, that could be where he is. Let's see here. So what it means when we're in attenuator mode is we're definitely really close to the snake. So you got to stay right behind me in a single file line so we don't accidentally step on him. Unless he is in that big oak, which it's a very good possibility with this really strong signal.
Look up, he's hanging above us.
Never know. Everybody just kind of look on top of these plants.
You think he could really be laying on this?
Oh, I've seen him laying on top of things like these rhododendrons and these mountain laurels. Oh, yeah. I found him.
You did?
Okay, everybody come right up here to where I am. Try not to stomp your feet too much. He's laying on a rhododendron. Yeah, check him out. Walk very silently.
If you scare him, he'll move.
Yeah, we don't want to scare him. Check him out.
Nice, he's pretty.
Isn't he cool?
Seeing a wild snake, that is so cool.
Isn't that neat? Now y'all stay right there.
So come around this way?
Yeah, bring my pack if you don't mind.
No tree touching.
Right, I'm gonna go run through the hemlock forest.
Yep, do it just like that.
I'm just trying to.
Here.
Hello.
Right, cool. Thanks, man. So here's Apollo from this angle. And he's just doing his best to be motionless and hope that we don't see him.
Tennis.
Now, I don't know if you guys noticed, but you can see how he, even though he's stretched out on the limb, he's kinked his body up into, it looks like lumps in his body, little kinks, okay? And what rat snakes will do is they kink their body up like that to sort of look like a dead stick or a stick in general. And the thought is that it helps predators or maybe keeps predators from seeing him because it acts as a camouflage. Nobody knows for sure because we don't speak snake, but it seems that, well, if you think about it, a big black snake like this, what do you think his top predators would be?
Hawks.
What's that?
Hawks.
Hawks, you're right. Hawks and owls and eagles. So he's laying out on a limb where hawks, owls, and eagles might see him. If he moves, he's dead. So if he stays still and looks like a stick, the hawks, owls, and eagles aren't going to see him because they're not hunting sticks. They're hunting snakes and rabbits and things like that. Things that move. So let's leave them alone and collect the data. All right, guys, hold on before I put this down. All right, everybody, very good job tracking Mr. Apollo. This is the first time we've seen him in a new place in about a month. So really cool information here. Good job. Oh, you can do better than that.
Woo!
Yay!
All right, so before I start collecting the data, you know, with my field notebook and all, I gotta go get his temperature with this infrared thermometer. Sixty-two point three. Did you see the tongue flick?
Yeah.
That was a foot from his body, and he barely moved. He tongue flicked though. He probably knows me. You know, he knows my scent because he did live in the nature center for about 3 weeks.
It's that guy.
What do you say?
It's that guy.
Okay, so here's one last look at Apollo before we leave. He's slowly moving off the limb. I guess he's had enough of us, but let's take a look at his incision while he's up here. See how good it looks. You can still see a suture there. Those are dissolvable sutures and they will dissolve, of course, probably when he sheds his skin again so that he'll lose those sutures. Oh, that's really awesome. Check him out.
And then I go and like hit one of them in the back. Yeah. And then like I run up to the bus and then they run to the house. It sounds like wild. And
hey guys, hang on a second. I'm filming him. He's actually moving very slowly. I think he's gonna go down to the ground. This is really cool. Wait till you see this video. I'm filming on my phone.
Awesome.
It looks really cool. Oh, this is so cool. And I'm not gonna move. It's hurting my muscles. I'm so stiff right now because I'm being so still. But he's coming towards me. He may crawl right over me. I don't know what's gonna happen.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Just don't move, guys. Be very still. He's coming right towards the camera. Coming right past the camera. He's staring at the camera now.
Make sure you get me on my good side. Don't get my good side. Looks like you're good,
buddy. Hey guys, would somebody come behind me? Wait, wait, wait. Yeah, you got to go very slow. Come up behind me. Don't hit any branches. Grab the GoPro and turn it on and film me filming him. This might look really cool. Because I don't want to move.
to be as careful as I can.
Okay, and just grab it and push the button on top. It's not on.
Red circle?
The top, the one on the top. Just push it once until it beeps one time.
I have a good shot of his head.
Don't move. He's looking right at me. I don't want to scare him, but I'm going to slowly back up. Okay, let's leave him alone. I don't really want to bother him much more. This is too much. But anyway, that was pretty cool snake encounter there. Go back to camera, to still camera mode and take a still shot of this. Cool. Good job, man. Okay, so it's been about 15 minutes. We've been down there collecting our data, and we've come up and we're heading out to leave the forest. And I thought I would turn on the receiver to try to find Apollo again and see where he'd moved to, because he has left the limb. Here's the limb he was on. It seems that he's crawled under, probably in this hole at the base of this roto. Check this out. There's a hole here. He's gone underground under this rhododendron, down into that hole. This is probably where he's going to spend the night. Pretty cool, guys. That is some good stuff right there, guys. Thanks for helping out.